favorite hymns. When we were singing more of Jesus, there's a reason for that change. The Lord said in Matthew chapter 11, take my yoke upon you and learn not about me, but of me. And may the Lord enable us to do that tonight. Now let's look at this passage of Scripture again, and I want to read it the way the world reads this passage of Scripture. Beginning in verse 6. Whosoever abideth in him does not practice sin. He does not sin habitually. It's not the bent and tenor of his life. Whosoever sinneth, whosoever practices sin, hath not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness, that's the bent and tenor of his life, he practices righteousness, is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that habitually practices sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God does not practice sin habitually, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot practice sin because he is born of God. Now that's the way the world reads that passage of Scripture. Is that what it means? Verse 7, little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous even as he, the Lord Jesus Christ, even as he is righteous. That one who does righteousness is righteous. The only way you can do righteousness is if you are righteous. And that righteousness is even as he, the Lord Jesus Christ, is righteous. Now that's saying a lot, isn't it? Look in verse 29 of chapter 2. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born, is birthed of him. In order to do righteousness, even as he is righteous, you have to be birthed. You have to be born of him. Verse 8. He that committeth sin is of the devil. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. You know, he was sinning before Adam and Eve. He's the one who tempted Adam and Eve. He was the originator of sin. Now, for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. And what are the works of the devil? He causes the commission of sin. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed, God's seed, remains in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. He's got a divine seed in him that renders him unable to sin. And the reason he is unable to sin is because he cannot sin. He lacks the ability to sin. Now, like I said, in all of these verses, men use practices or practices habitually, and most people who use that view will admit that a believer sometimes sins. Maybe he oftentimes sins, but he doesn't sin habitually. That's not the tenor and the course of his life. Now, if that is the interpretation of that passage of Scripture, you'd also have to say this.
He that's born of God sins occasionally. That which is born of God, it does sin. It just doesn't sin habitually. It doesn't sin as the bent and tenor of his life, but that which is born of God does commit sin, which is a complete denial of everything this passage of Scripture is saying. He that's born of God doth not commit sin. For his seed, the seed of God, the new birth, regeneration, being born of the Spirit, remaineth in him. It never leaves. And he cannot sin. He lacks the ability to sin because he is born of God. Now, I want to try to talk to you about this subject, born of God, what it does and what it does not do. Now, that's an interesting subject, isn't it? Born of God, what it does and what it does not do. Now, the reason, before I go on with this passage of Scripture, the reason we must be born of God is because we don't have spiritual life. We're dead in sins. Every man by nature is totally depraved. Now, I could go on and on talking about what all that means, but let this suffice. When the disciples saw that rich young ruler leave the Lord, they said, "Who then can be saved? If this man can't be saved, who then can be saved?" And the Lord looked at them and said, "With men, it is impossible." Now that's what total depravity means, very simply. With men, I could go on and talk about how the affections are depraved and the will is chained to a sinful nature and the mind is darkened by sin, and there's all kinds of things we could say about total depravity, what the Scripture teaches. But here's the bottom line. Who then can be saved? With men, it is impossible. Dead in sins. And if I'm dead in sins, the only way I can believe, the only way I can come to Christ, the only way I can repent is if God births me, if He gives me life from the dead. Now, I want to look at the New Testament Scriptures. This is taught in the Old Testament too. The teaching is uniform, and as Exodus 36, God talks about the, not Exodus 36, Ezekiel 36 and Jeremiah 31, God talks about the new heart I'll give you and the new spirit I'll put within you. I mean, this is the way believers have always been saved. But I want to look at the New Testament Scriptures that deal with being born of God and see if we can learn what being born of God does do and what being born of God does not do. Now first, turn with me to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. This is the first time in the New Testament we read of this thing of being born of God. John chapter 1, beginning in verse 11. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power or the right or the privilege to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born. There it is. Which were born. Not of blood. You're not born again because your mom or dad are born again. You're not a Christian because your mom or dad are a Christian. Not of the will of the flesh. A man doesn't use his will to decide to become born. Free will is the most ridiculous thing there is. It's just anti-gospel. It's anti-God. And think it. Can you imagine a being that has not yet been conceived decide, well, I'm going to be conceived. I'm going to be. That's ridiculous, isn't it? It's just as ridiculous to think of free will being involved in the salvation of the sinner. They were born not of blood, not of the will of the flesh, not of the will of man. You're not born again because a bunch of people got together and started praying for you and said, we're not going to leave the Lord alone until He actually saves that person. No, no one's saved because of that. Why were you born? Of God. Which were born, not of blood, not of the will of the flesh, not of the will of man, but of God. Now, what is the evidence you've been born of God? Well, look in verse 11 again. He came unto His own, and His own received Him not, but as many as received Him. Now, this is what people who are born of God do. They receive the Lord Jesus Christ. And I think it's amazing how people say, see there, there's works involved. You got to receive. Well, if you don't receive, He never gave. If He gave, you will receive. And if you're in need, and I see you in need, and I say, well, here's $100 to help you out. And you say, well, at least I received it. You know, I'd probably take it back. People try to make receiving some kind of meritorious action. It is not. The only reason you receive is He gave you the grace to receive. Of His fullness have we all received, grace for grace. You know, it takes grace to receive grace. Now, here's the ones who have been born of God, but as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name. Now, when I'm believing on His name, what's that mean? It means the same thing as Romans 10:13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, when I'm calling upon the name of the Lord is who He is. It's His attributes. It's His characteristics. It's His justice. It's His holiness. It's His sovereignty. It's His power. It's His wisdom. When I'm believing on His name, I'm believing on His name, save me by Your justice. That's in Your name. Save me by Your grace. Save me by Your mercy. Save me by Your power. A believer finds all of his salvation in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now that is who is born of God, those who receive Him, those who believe on His name. Turn to John chapter 3. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. As a matter of fact, he was on the Sanhedrin. The same came to Jesus by night. Some say it's because he was embarrassed to come to Christ and didn't want anybody to know about it. That may be the case, but I think that the language means more of this. He came in utter darkness. He came in night with no light at all. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto Him, Rabbi, we know that Thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that Thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God. We cannot possibly see, perceive, or understand the things of God without being born from above. It's absolutely necessary. You see, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. This is in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for their foolishness unto him. I wonder how many times I've preached and somebody listens and said, that's foolishness. Well, it is to a natural man. It doesn't make sense to him. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, their foolishness unto him, neither indeed can he know them. He lacks the ability to know them because they're spiritually discerned. I have to have a spiritual nature given to me in the new birth by God the Holy Spirit for me to be able to hear and understand the gospel. Now, I don't care if the preacher is the most simple, best illustration, can preach the gospel more simply than anybody else. The natural man cannot understand it unless God the Holy Spirit gives them life from the dead. Now, a monkey could not understand calculus, no matter how good the teacher was, could he? And the natural man cannot understand the gospel, no matter how good the teacher may be, unless God the Holy Spirit gives him life from the dead. Look in verse 4 of this same chapter. Nicodemus saith unto him, Well, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of water, and I have no doubt that that water is not talking about water baptism. That's talking about the water of the Word. The Word is quite often described as water. And there's no new birth apart from hearing the Word of God. Except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, there's no entering the kingdom of God without the new birth. You see, there's no knowledge of sin. You know, you take any natural man and he has no understanding of sin. He looks at it totally as behavioral. I messed up. I did this. I did that. But he doesn't understand sin as being a nature. He doesn't understand that the reason he sins is because he's a sinner. That's his nature. There's no understanding of faith in Christ. There's no coming to Christ. There's no believing on Christ. There's no entering the kingdom of heaven apart from being given a new nature, being birthed by God. Now, what that means is, if God leaves me alone, that's all he's got to do. If God leaves me alone, I'll go to hell. I'll never believe. I'll never repent. I'll never love God. Look in verse 6. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Now that which is born of the flesh will not and cannot rise above its nature. That which is born of the flesh, it's always going to be just that, flesh. Paul said in Romans chapter 8, verse 7, the carnal mind is enmity against God. It's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. That which is born of the flesh can never rise above what it is, flesh, sinful, fallen flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Now that's spiritual life. It's only that which is born of the Spirit that can see the beauty of Christ and come to Christ and enter into the things of God. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Look what he says in verse 17. Marvel not that I say unto you, you must be born again. It's absolutely necessary for you to be born again. You will not enter the kingdom of heaven. You will not believe. You will not do anything spiritual unless you're born again. It's absolutely necessary for me or you to be born from above. Verse 8. The wind blows where it wills. That's what listeth mean. The wind blows where it wills. Now, how much control do you have over the wind? It blows one way, it blows another. And you know how much control you have? None. I know the Lord says He holds the winds in His fist. He controls the wind. But me and you don't have any control of the wind. The wind blows where it wills. You hear the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh or whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Now what this is a reference to is the sovereignty of God in the work of the Holy Spirit. He gives life to whom He will. You can't control it. There's nothing you can do to cause this to happen. He gives life to whom He will. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. I think it's interesting. Billy Graham actually wrote a book entitled How to Be Born Again. The Bible doesn't tell you how to be born again. It just says you must be born again. And this is the sovereign work of God. He gives life to whom He will. Now turn to Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4. Verse 23. But he who is of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. Now, read verses 22 through 24. For it's written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman. But he who is of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise, which things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants. The one from Mount Sinai, which genders to bondage, is Hagar. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai, and answers to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. Now, this is a reference to what happened in Genesis chapter 16. You remember the story. God had promised Abraham, you're going to have a child. Years pass. Genesis chapter 16, Sarah says, we're not going to have that child unless we do our part. Obviously, he's restrained me from bearing. I haven't had a child. So you go into Hagar, my young Egyptian maid. You have a child through her, and that'll be our child. Abraham said, okay, I'll do that. And what came of that union? Ishmael. God never acknowledged Ishmael as a son. The son of the bondmaid will not be son with the free woman. So some years later, Sarah, after she's already gone through menopause, has a child through Abraham. One is natural, is fleshly. There's no miracle about it. The other is a supernatural miracle of grace. Now, here's the point. The flesh is works. The spirit is grace. That's the difference. The flesh represents salvation by works, and the spirit represents salvation by grace. And look what verse 29 says. But as in he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. You know, it's always been that way. Grace and works will never get along. Works, the flesh, will always persecute that one who's born after the Spirit. They cannot coexist. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. Verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us. There's the word, hath birthed us, hath borne us again unto a lively hope, a living hope, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now this being begotten again unto a living hope comes to us for one reason. Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. That's why it comes. Because Christ was raised from the dead. Everything that was against me was blotted out, and now I am given life. I didn't ask for it. I didn't do anything to get it. But because Christ was raised from the dead, and that means all my sin was put away, blotted out, canceled, because of that, Christ can give me life. I don't say, give me life, although I do. I say it all the time. Lord, give me life. But the only reason I say that is because I have life. I didn't initially ask for life. He gave me life for this one singular reason, the person and work of Christ, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. Look in verse 23 of 1 Peter chapter 1. Being born again. There's the word. Being born again, not of corruptible seed. Corruptible seed is works. Works cannot produce life. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Now there's no birth apart from hearing the Word of God, apart from hearing the gospel. You know, I've had somebody say to me once, they said, you believe in gospel regeneration. I reckon I do. I don't have any problem with that. Paul said in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. There's no salvation apart from the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if I'm born again, it's going to be because I've heard the message. And God gave me life to receive it. And it brings forth fruit. There's no being born again apart from hearing the gospel message. And he gives us a summary as we go on reading as what that gospel message is. Verse 24, here it is. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever, for all flesh is as grass. And all the glory of man is the flower of the grass. The grass withers, the flower thereof falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now that's what you hear. All flesh is grass. I love that passage in Isaiah 40 where Isaiah said, the voice said, cry. And I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass. My flesh, your flesh, there's nothing to it. The goodliness thereof is like the flower of grass that withers and fades away. That's all human merit, human righteousness. There's no such thing. But what's the one thing that will endure? The word of the Lord Jesus Christ. He shall endure forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. Turn to 1 John chapter 2. I've already read this once, but let's read it again. Verse 29. If you know that he is righteous, speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ, speaking of God, if you know that he is righteous. Now, most folks, if you ask them, you believe God's righteous? They'd say, yes, I believe God's righteous, but they don't really know he's righteous, and that is seen in the other stuff they believe. What do you mean by that? Well, if you believe in salvation by works in any way, you don't believe God's righteous. You brought him down to your level. You thought, I love what the Lord said, you thought I was altogether such a one as yourself. If you believe in salvation by works in any way, you don't believe in his righteousness. You wouldn't believe salvation by works if you did. If you believe that Jesus Christ can shed his precious blood for somebody and pay for their sins and they wind up in hell anyway, you don't believe he's righteous. You have no understanding of the righteousness of God. If you don't see the righteousness of Jesus Christ as your only righteousness and the only way you come into God's presence, you don't believe he's righteous. Most people have no concept or understanding of the righteousness of God. But if you do, I know you'll believe in the successful atonement of Christ. If you do, I know you'll believe his righteousness is the only righteousness. If you do believe he's righteous, you won't dare come into God's presence on the footing of your works. But look what it says. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. Now this doing of righteousness can only be the result of being born of God, being given a new nature, a holy nature. The scripture actually says partakers of the divine nature. It is impossible to do righteousness if you're not born of God, because the scripture says our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. Now this is something that only the new nature, being born of God, can do. It's the doing of righteousness. And somebody says, well, what is the doing of righteousness? Well, it's being righteous. Well, how do you be righteous? It's the life of the believer. It's being poor in spirit. It's mourning before God over your sin. It's being meek before God. It's hungering and thirsting for righteousness. It's being merciful. It's being pure in heart. It's being a peacemaker. It's being persecuted for righteousness' sake. Now that's the doing of righteousness. It's the what a believer is. It's the new birth. It's the new nature. If you know anybody that does righteousness, you know the only reason they do it is because they're born of God. The only way someone can have the Beatitudes, there's only someone can have the fruit of God, the Holy Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, is because they have been born of God. There is no other reason. You know that. Look in verse 9 of 1 John chapter 3. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. Now, here's what it doesn't do. Whosoever is born of God, whatever it is, is born of God. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. You see, holiness cannot sin. Did you know that? Holiness cannot sin. It's impossible. The new nature cannot sin. This is that meek and quiet spirit that Peter spoke of in 1 Peter chapter 3, even in the which is not corruptible, which is not subject to corruption, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit. It cannot sin. Now, can God sin? No, perish the thought. Can the Lord Jesus Christ sin? No, He's impeccable. Can God the Holy Spirit sin? Obviously not. Can the divine nature sin? No. 2 Peter 1:4 says we're partakers of the divine nature. That which is born of God cannot sin. Now, here's the fact. The old nature doesn't do anything but sin. And the new nature never sins. That's what the Bible teaches. That's what the new birth does. Look in 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Beloved, 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Now, the love he's speaking of is not human love. It's not the love between a husband and wife. It's not the love between a parent and a child. It's not the love between people who are friends and really are close to one another and depend on one another. It's not a love like that at all. Now, I'm thankful for those kind of loves, aren't you? I mean, we'd be in bad shape without them, and I'm thankful for those loves, but a lost man can practice all those loves. The love he's talking about is an actual love for God as He is and a love for His people as they are. Now, that's the supernatural love he's speaking of. Now, if I'm born of God, I love God as He is. You know what that means? It means I love His holiness. I love His sovereignty. I love His justice. I love His power. I love His grace. I love His immutability. I love His eternity. Everything about God, I love. I love Him as He is. I wouldn't change Him if I could. And He's the only one who I'd say that about. Anybody else, I'd change him to make it more to where somehow I'd benefit from it. But not God. I love Him as He is, and I love His people as they are. How are they? In Christ. And we love His way of saving. Everyone that loveth is born of God. He that loveth not knoweth not God. Look at chapter 5, verse 1. Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth Him that begat loveth Him also that is begotten of Him. Now, if you love Him that begat, you're going to love everybody that's begotten of Him. But look at again, whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. Now, take that for what it says. I had someone say to me once when I quoted this passage of Scripture and said, anybody that believes Jesus is the Christ is born of God. He said, that's making it too simplistic. Is it? Take this for what it says. Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ? That He is God's Messiah? God's anointed? He's God's anointed prophet? He's the Word of God? All that God has to say is Jesus Christ. Do you believe that? When He says, this is My beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased, hear ye Him. He's God's prophet. He's God's priest, that priest after the order of Melchizedek, where if He represents you, you must be saved. He's God's king. That means He rules and reigns. The king is the one whose will must be done. I need Him as my king to cause me to do His will. I need Him to cause me to come to the Lord Jesus Christ, to cause me to live, to preserve me. I love Him being the Christ. whoso believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. Don't think this is too simple. If you believe he's the Christ, you're born of God. Look in verses 4 and 5 of 1 John chapter 5. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? Now that person is born of God who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Now what I'd like for you to do just for a moment is to completely forget about yourself. Now what do I mean by that? Don't try to figure out if you're saved. Don't try to figure out if Christ died for you. Don't try to figure out if you're one of God's elect. Don't try to figure out if you've been born again. Just get yourself out of the picture. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? That's all I'm asking. It doesn't matter what you believe about yourself. Do you remember when the Lord said to Peter, the disciples, whom say men that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, well, they say you're John the Baptist or one of the prophets, but whom say ye that I am? Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah. Flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. But my Father, which is in heaven, thou art Peter, upon this rock, this confession of me, will I build my church. Now, do you remember when the Lord was watching the crowd leaving after he preached that message on John chapter 6? And he looked at the disciples and he said, will you also go away? Here's your opportunity if you want to leave. You can leave incognito with everybody else. Nobody will notice. And Peter answered, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life, and we believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God. He didn't say we believe and are sure we're saved. He didn't say we believe and we're sure the Christ died for us. What he was sure about is who Christ is. What about the Ethiopian eunuch? After he heard, either here or in the back, I don't remember where it was, we were hearing Isaiah 53 read, and I was thinking, wouldn't you have loved to have been able to hear Philip start preaching from that passage of Scripture? When he was reading that, and Philip began at that same Scripture, Isaiah 53, and preached unto him Jesus. And evidently, he'd said something about baptism as well. I'm sure he did. When the gospel's preached, you're going to call on people to confess Christ and believers' baptism. And so here, this man sees this pool of water after hearing Peter preach, and he says, what hinders me from being baptized? If there's a reason, I want to know, what hinders me? And Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That's faith. If you believe that he is the Son of God, I'm not asking if you believe you're saved or if you believe that your experience is right or if you forget yourself. What do you believe concerning him? I don't care what you think about yourself. Just forget it. It doesn't have anything to do with faith. What do you believe concerning him? That's the only issue. I think of Peter after the terrible fall he had. If you would have said to him, do you believe you're saved, Peter? I got my doubts. Do you believe Christ died for you? I don't know. Do you believe that you're one of the elect? I don't know. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Yes, I do. Remember, the Lord prayed that his faith fail not. Now, did he have assurance? I'm not sure if he had any assurance. Probably he didn't, because as a matter of fact, the angels said, you go tell the disciples and you make sure you tell Peter that I'm risen. I imagine Peter probably assumed he wasn't a disciple anymore. He thought he denied the Lord. But faith is not what you believe about yourself. Faith is what you believe about him only. Now, who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? Look at John chapter 5, verse 18. We know, this is the last one. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. We've already seen that. But whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But he that is begotten of God, what's he do? He keeps himself. And that wicked one touches him not. Now, what's it mean to keep yourself? I know exactly what it means. When you keep yourself, that means you abide in Christ. You don't go outside of him. You know that you don't want to be anywhere but in Christ. You don't want to be seen anywhere else, only in Christ. And that's the only place Satan can't touch you, is in Christ. Now, he can touch you any other way. He touched Job, didn't he? And Job was a believer. He touched Job, and he can touch you. He can turn you inside out. If he tempts you, how you reckon you're going to be able to stand? He can touch you in that sense. But in Christ, he can't touch you. He that is begotten of God keeps himself. And you know what he does? He keeps himself in Christ. He doesn't want to be found anywhere else. This is a conscious desire to only be found in Christ. That one who's begotten of God keeps himself. And that wicked one does not touch him. That is persevering, being in Christ, because you've been preserved, because you've been begotten of God. Only that one who's begotten of God abides in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this thing of being born of God, it's true. We're by nature dead in sins. And we can't give ourselves life. But there is such a thing as being born of God. We can't enter heaven without it. It's necessary for salvation. It's the sovereign work of God. It's grace and works. It cannot sin. It must do righteousness. It's necessary for love, and it's believing Christ. Not what you believe about yourself. It's what you believe concerning him. May God give us all this new birth. Let's pray. Lord, we ask in Christ's name that we might be born from above, birthed by your Spirit, given spiritual life. Oh Lord, what a glorious, glorious thing to have the life of God abiding in our soul. Bless this message for Christ's sake. In his name we pray. Amen. Matt, come lead us the closing hymn.